this is a doctor bird. It is this tiny little hummingbird that's native to Jamaica. It's our national bird, and it has this iridescent green coating, and the males, so this is a little guy, because the males only have this super long tail, which is what makes them distinctive, and it looks like the old school doctor's coattails, so very special to us. So it's really fun because she's our friend. Obviously, we're happy to carry her wine, but every time we pour a taste or she pours a taste, the wine sells because it's that good. So
okay,
it's not just because she's our friend.
And I just want to make sure I pronounce this right. It's called Nonsuch.
Nonsuch.
Okay, Nonsuch Syrah. Okay.
Nonsuch. Yeah, Nonsuch.
There's no other like it.
All right, so this is going to be fun, like get to interview and drink at the same time. So this is like my kind of interview that I like. Yes.
It's always a party here. We try to keep the fun going.
Okay.
Yeah, that's for sure.
I like that. So welcome to Knowledge and Relationships. This is your boy M3. And I'm having another interview, in-person interview. And this is going to be good because I'm hosting like a couple who owns like their pretty much their organic like business. Pretty much like they have a winery and they have like other organics as well too, that if you could look around, man, it's going to be nice. Don't move the camera too much there. But as we were talking about, like, you know, some like the wines that they sell.
But she has to move to come cheers.
Salute.
That's right.
Thank you for being here.
No problem. You might have to try to check the camera and make sure like it's good. Okay. And you still got us in a shot?
Yes.
All right, well, cool.
All right, well, enjoy your wine.
Yeah. So Danielle and Zane, like, yes, it's definitely nice to like to meet you guys.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to like, you know, getting to know you guys, like the business and also like, you know, relationship questions as well. But first, I want to kind of get into the business of Dr. Bird Market. So my first question, I want to just jump into it, is like the background and the inspiration. What inspired you both to open Dr. Bird Market, and how did you choose the name for the store?
You want to start or you want me to start?
This one's good.
And it will keep getting better as it opens up.
Yeah,
for sure. Well, we moved to Pittsburgh in 2022. When did we move here?
2022.
Okay. We moved here in 2022. And when we settled into this community down in the Marina and Old Town area of Pittsburgh, we quickly realized that we were missing some of the things that we really like, which is small production wine and small production beer and certain food items. And so rather than be sad that we couldn't find those things in Pittsburgh, we decided to just open a store.
Okay.
And so that's kind of the reason that we did it.
Inspired by what was missing, and it's what we know best. So we were, I guess, positioned to provide this for the community. We started talking to our neighbors and realizing everybody missed the same things that we missed. So we had the ability to do it, and then we just did it. So
okay.
But the name, if you want to know about the name, so what is a doctor bird?
Yeah.
So the doctor bird is these tiny little hummingbirds that you see flying around everywhere. That's our logo.
Okay.
And it's a species of hummingbird. It is the national bird of Jamaica. So, oh, thank you for the plug. So, you know, any Jamaicans out there will instantly recognize it. It's native to Jamaica. In pre-colonial times, it was sacred to the Arawak Indians. They considered it to be a gift from the gods. It was a messenger from the gods to the spirit, from the spirit world to the human world. And it brought people the gift of medicine.
Wow.
And fast forward many, many years, it's our national bird. It's a symbol of our country. And then the tourist board uses it as a little icon to show people all the good things that are not to be missed. So it's like you'll see all these little signs around in the tourist areas, you know, follow the doctor bird.
Okay.
And the doctor bird shows you where all the good stuff is. And so we started using the name
when we were doing some Jamaican pop-up dinners in San Francisco and Oakland. And we had retired the name because we thought, okay, that's our restaurant concept.
Yeah.
And we'll come back to that when we're ready to open our Jamaican restaurant. But then we were looking for a name for this shop, and it just kept coming back to us. And all our friends already know the name, and we have so much goodwill built into the name that, you know, and it's kind of what we're doing here. We're bringing all the good stuff together. We've got around the garden and picked up all the good things and brought them here. So it's just, it's a symbol of warmth and hospitality and good living. And it's bad luck to kill one.
Yeah. Definitely, Bella. You know, we don't condone killing hummingbirds. Okay. I'm a bird lover myself.
So,
I have we have 9 parakeets. Oh, well, we had the max of 13, but of course we're over time.
That's like us with cats.
We don't want to talk about the cats.
We don't talk
cats
about
eat birds, remember? Okay, we're talking about birds.
All right, move on.
But the Dr. Bird, you know, I have to say the Dr. Bird name and like the its origin for us is also a deeper part of the origin of the store, which is that you know, when we first met and started to realize that we both had this passion for not only hospitality and food service in the restaurant world, but also just for entrepreneurship. And so for over a decade of us being married, you know, we've consistently come back to this, like, we really just, we want to have our own business. We want to be entrepreneurs. We want to be our own bosses. And that, we just kept coming back to it. We've worked many different jobs each in different places over the course of our marriage, but it always comes back to, we wanted to be our own bosses. And so this is really, even though it's a need in the community, but it was also a need for us. It was something that we needed to do because it's what deep down we really wanted. And that started with the Dr. Bird restaurant concept, but now it's turned into a retail store to start. We'll see where it goes from here. Because, you know, she's a chef and I'm a sommelier. So between the two of us, we have the makings to open a restaurant too.
I could have led with that, huh?
you're a chef,
som, hence the food and the wine.
Yeah.
For the viewers, can you like define the word? So you say you're a som?
Yeah, sommelier. It's a French term that basically means a wine guy. Really and truly. And you'd most often see a sommelier like in a restaurant, and he'd be the person who would, or they would be the person to come and take your wine order and help guide you through the wine list and then bring the bottle and open it and serve it, just like I just did with that. And that's that's what a sommelier is. Anymore, there are many different variations on what a sommelier is because, you know, I'm obviously not serving wine to anyone most of the time in this store. I'm simply guiding them.
But
I curate the list and you know, you're a person who's really into wine. It's a very fancy way of saying wine nerd.
Somebody
knows.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's the truth.
No, but that's good. And it's like, okay, like something that you truly like love to do, and then like you're combining like as one, especially like you guys are like a couple as well too. So that's even a big plus. Like it's like-minded people. And to me, like the way how I look at it is that, yeah, it's like, okay, I understand like the norm, right? Is, you know, you go to school, you know, get a degree, you work at a job for the rest of your life, and you're making the other person rich, you know, that owns the company. But to really like educate yourself, like to get out there and to have the willpower to like just go through like, you know, maybe rough moments or just like tough times, like where you're trying to start the business. Because I know starting a business, like, it's not really that easy. Like,
really?
Well, maybe for you guys. Like, I should.
it's not easy.
it takes so much courage and resilience, and it can be terrifying, you know.
Yeah.
So, I mean, hats off to you, too.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. But, it's I know it's not easy work because you got to have, like, you know, a plan. Then you got to go through maybe the city, the fire marshal, things like that, get a zone. I could just like imagine like just like the steps, but
health department.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, that's
okay, they're reference.
But let me get to the second question, right? Because product selection is so in the process of this, how do you decide which products to feature in your store, especially the organic oils, the cocktails, the wines, the cheeses as well too.
Yeah. I will say it has been a little bit of a process of trial and error. So we knew, we started with wine. So we wanted to be, originally we thought we were just going to be a wine shop.
Yeah.
And we took the idea to the city and they were very excited about the idea. But mm-hmm. when it came to zoning, if we were only a wine shop, then we would be we would have to be coded as a liquor store.
And
they don't allow liquor stores in this area. It's a historic district. It's residential. There's schools. There's churches. So liquor stores, per se, are not allowed down here. So then we thought, well, this kind of forces us to lean into our strengths on the food side.
Yeah.
So let's, you know, increase the selection, expand, and play more to my strengths. Because really, he's the wine guy.
Mm-hmm.
And so we started kind of playing around with things that would support the support and complement the mm-hmm. wine sales. And so we started expanding the food selection. And so it started with our best guess, really. That's what it is. And, and a little bit of tweaking. And we've had some really unexpected hits and a couple misses. And that's okay too, you know? And you have to just expect that and be willing to.
You mind if I ask what were the
unexpected hits?
Okay, hits. Okay, plus, I thought you were going to ask about my misses. The unexpected hits, bar soap.
Goat milk bar soap.
We carry these beautiful goat milk bar soaps, and I added them as kind of sort of an afterthought. They're food adjacent because they're made with all natural ingredients that are technically edible. Do not eat soap. I'm not telling anybody.
Don't eat it.
But they're technically edible.
Unless you've been bad.
No. That's the whole thing.
Wash your mouth soap.
But no, I mean, they've been received so well. And that, you know, that was not what we meant to build the core of our business around. But they make great gifts and they're really good for you.
Yeah.
And that is what guides the selection of pretty much everything that's in here. So There are a couple criteria that we use when we're deciding what to carry. And the first thing is that it has to be high quality and it has to have simple ingredients. So nothing that's like super high processed with a whole long list of ingredients, a ton of sugar, a ton of salt. We're not a health store, but we want to promote a good life. And good high quality food is part of a good life.
So what would be the proper name for me to like call your store? Like, because I mean, to me, when I look at, I'm like, this is like our organic store. Like, cause
it's mostly organic.
Yeah.
It just happened to work out that way.
Okay.
We're a specialty food market.
A specialty food market. Yeah. So let me make sure I correct myself. It is a specialty food market. So
that gives us room to play with, you know, different iterations. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, now I will go back to the miss or whatever. I didn't forget about that, but I just wanted to.
Whole wheat pasta.
We cannot sell whole wheat pasta.
It's the weirdest thing.
What?
We moved here from Berkeley and Santa Rosa, right?
Yeah.
So a lot of like super healthy eaters where like whole wheat pasta is like, of course, that's what you do, but we cannot sell
and it. It's good. Pasta, it's from a pasta maker in Oakland, so it's local, it's a small business, and it's really good quality stuff, but man, it just...
But it would have been a good combination, wine and pasta.
I know what we're saying, and we tried to push it, but not many takers. You know, and that's just part of doing that dance, too. Like, we know what we want to sell, we know what we want to eat, but in the end, it's not about us.
Mm-hmm.
It's about our audience.
Right.
It's about our market. So.
Yeah,
I understand. So... Now, with the local community impact, can you share how your store has impacted the local community in Old Town Pittsburgh?
I mean, that's going to be a developing story, I think.
Okay.
In the first 4 months of us being here, what it has done is I think it's inspired the people who live down in Old Town to get excited about what's coming.
Mm-hmm.
Because there was a lot of motion. Obviously, we didn't move here until 2022. But up until about 2019, there was a lot of motion to really bring Old Town Pittsburgh up into a new level. And it faltered because of COVID. And that's true for so many places around the country. And it's just taken a while for it to get back on track. And so I think that what we've really done first and foremost is like given inspiration and excitement to our community that good things are coming and that this is going to just continue on an upward trajectory.
Yeah, but just building a little bit of that community spirit and community pride too. Like, we have something really nice in our community. You need to come down here.
Yes.
Yeah.
And as always, you know, I always wish like, you know, like you guys like the best because you guys have a good thing that's going on. And, you know, I understand like, you know, sometimes it takes a minute before growth begins to happen, but I could see like the change happening.
Good, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. So then, okay, a good one. Personal favorites. I like this one. So business owners, do you have any personal favorite products in your store? If so, what are they and why?
You asking us to choose our favorite child?
Well,
you start,
cause. Oh my gosh! I mean, that's a really hard question to answer because you know, if we didn't like it, it wouldn't be in the store because we're obviously a very small space, and therefore we have to be intentional about what we pick and put on the shelves.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I think that I'm most proud on the wine side of the things that we sell that you really can't buy anywhere else. Which this, you know, not because we're drinking it and because she's a friend, but also because it's a great product. But you can't really buy this wine retail in very many places. We also have wines from a winery in Sonoma called Vianza. They grow a lot of Italian varietals, so Italian grapes, but they grow them right there in Sonoma County. And they don't sell their wine to other retailers. And so it's another example of like, you can't buy their wine anywhere but at the winery and here.
Yeah.
And so like I'm proud and that's like one of my favorite children is the wines from Vianza. And also they're doing a great, really great job with Italian varietals here in California. And there's a lot of people that would say, oh, it's Italian and you can't make it outside of Italy. But they're doing a really good job with that.
Wow. And that really like makes like, you know, like your business like stands out from like the rest of the competition. People don't know, like you're getting like exclusive like wines like from other people, other vendors and stuff. So that's something that you cannot take really lightly, you know?
That's a good point. I really love that we have a personal connection with so many of the wines and the other foods too. I'm really proud of myself for adding this meat and cheese fridge right here.
Yeah.
And we have this really great selection of cheeses. We have a sprinkling of imported cheeses, like really good Italian cheeses in there. But for the most part, Sonoma County makes some of the best cheese in the world. And they're right there and they're really easy to get to. So it takes, you know, our carbon footprint in getting that cheese here is tiny, and it's really just nice to be able to show such high quality local products.
Yeah.
No, that's good. That's nice. And then, so the other question is like, I feel like it was kind of answered, but this one was about business challenges. And I know you already mentioned like, you know, because of like, you know, COVID, like that was happening, that pretty much like sometimes it could slow down, like, you know, like the growth of it. But were there any other like challenges besides COVID?
For us personally, for the business? Well, to be honest, COVID hasn't really been an impact for us and our business because we didn't start this until just last September.
Yeah.
But you know, I would say it kind of killed the foot traffic in this area.
That's the way that it impacted us is that it really kind of shut down progression in the Old Town area, which so there's this opinion amongst other folks that live in Pittsburgh, especially if they don't live down here, that nothing's happening in Old Town.
Yeah.
And that's a big challenge is getting folks outside of the Old Town area to wake up and go, oh, there is a reason to go down to the marina and go down to the Old Town area because there's stuff's happening here.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, I saw your interview with Tara down at Dale Vino.
So
I wanted to give them a plug too because they really inspired us to do this because we had just moved in when they opened, when they had their grand opening. And it was like, okay, when there is stuff to do, people show up and people like wine and there is this market for nice things down here. And she really was a pioneer. She took a chance on this area to like put something so nice here, so new. Mm-hmm. And you know, been bringing traffic back. And then La Veranda around the corner reopened. And they've brought a lot of business back to this area too. So, you know, we all need to kind of lock arms as small businesses.
Yeah, and bring the traffic right back. Yeah. Because
sometimes I know that old Pittsburgh usually kind of get a bad rap because of and you know, I didn't really like pay much attention, like, you know, the times that I'll probably pass through old town Pittsburgh, I was just like looking like, oh, okay, this is about to become like a desert, but you guys are actually bringing things like back to life in that small town, and I definitely appreciate you guys for doing so. And also shout outs to Miss Tara Sanders, because without her I would have never met you guys. Because how we met was because of a small business convention where small business owners, even though like I do YouTube on the side, but that, I guess you still consider it as a business as well, because you're still networking, you're still trying to grow and establish, and ultimately you're trying to make money, you know? So
we're all trying to live.
Yeah. Let me see, wine and bar selection. Your store offers a selection of wine and beer. Let's see, how do you curate the selection, and do you focus on any particular regions or types?
I mean, you could definitely walk down the wine shelves and accuse us of being playing favorites with Italy.
Yeah.
And to be honest, we kind of do, because I come from an Italian wine background, mm-hmm. and we met an Italian restaurant. So
we made wine together in Italy.
We made wine together in Italy. We've been and toured around Italian wine country, and mm-hmm. so we definitely have an affinity for Italian wine. But aside from that, what drives our selection for the wine and for the beer is small production mm-hmm. and family-run operations. It's really important that the wine that we sell is made by people who are also in the vineyards and have like a holistic approach to the entire production and don't make too much wine. Mm-hmm. And also that they don't sell it to Safeway. Like that's a big thing for us too, is that we are selling products that you can't buy anywhere else. One of the hashtags I put on every post is Pittsburgh's only wine shop, because there aren't any other actual wine shops in Pittsburgh.
Yeah,
and we don't want to be just another spot where you buy the same things you can get at Winco or Safeway.
Yeah.
And you'll notice too, we have little things where we call out female winemaker, black winemaker, because we really are trying to promote that and highlight the diversity that does exist in mm-hmm. the wine industry, and that historically wine has been, you know, it's just for rich old white guys, and that's absolutely not the case, and it's less and less the case now. So yeah, we do try to look for some of those hidden gems from underrepresented producers
mm-hmm.
as well.
Mm-hmm. And for the beer, I try really hard to buy beer from breweries that self-distribute.
Yeah.
So I don't have to buy the beer through some distributor and take money out of the pocket of the brewers. I'm actually getting it directly from the brewery, so that mm-hmm. way they get the most money from us, and that way it's a virtuous circle. Yeah.
Yeah. So in a nutshell, we're a small business that
supporting
other
small businesses.
And you know, and that's what made you guys like so awesome, because, you know, a lot of people, they could be in it for the money for themselves and they don't really care about like, you know, the middleman or a person that's like distributing, but you're looking out for both parties. Thank you. Appreciate it. You know, you're making sure like you guys are getting stuff established, but you're making sure that, you know, they're getting like commission or getting paid, you know, their payment as well too, though. That way everyone stays afloat of things.
And
no one's running dry.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. We look at ourselves as being part of a bigger community and an ecosystem of businesses. Small businesses are the backbone of America.
Yes.
So we need to keep each other afloat.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I think, you know, and I'm glad that you mentioned that, because the thing is that I think small businesses can easily get overlooked. We could always look at like, you know, the major name brand companies and thinking that, okay, well, those are the type of companies that help run America. But it's usually the small business like owners, the small business companies
that's like the backbone of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, whenever like you want to get pretty much like your own personalized quality of like wines and foods and other produce, go to your local small business store, because you guys going to make sure that you're going to give them the best.
Right.
Right.
Whereas opposed to some corporation, they're just going to just distribute whatever.
And we actually do care.
Yeah. And that's what I love to like patronize about small business, you know?
Same.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Customer. Oh, I'm sorry. I think I skipped something. Oh, there it is. Sustainable practices. Mm. What measures do you take to ensure sustainability in your business operations?
Well, I will say that because of the nature of what we sell, we don't generate a whole lot of waste. We're not a restaurant, like, you know, with a lot of food waste or anything like that. So, I mean, in general, we try to be as conscious as we can about recycling, about reusing packaging, you know, all the things that's just how we live at home.
Okay.
But I'd say for the most part, we try to support businesses that are operating responsibly and sustainably. So like with the example of sourcing our cheeses, we you know, drive up to Sonoma, we try to plan our trips and consolidate so we can drive up to Sonoma and pick up our local cheeses.
We
support a lot of companies like the popcorn that we have, another one of our surprise hits. They're not local, they're just over the border in Arizona, and they use all vegan, all non-GMO, minimal packaging, just like we try to really pay attention to that in our suppliers. So that's, you asked about earlier about how we select the stuff in the shop, and that's one of our criteria as well.
Okay. And then customer experience for people who's new to the shop, coming into the shop and first time coming in, how do you ensure a unique and enjoyable shopping experience for your customers?
You mean besides the fact that we have this crazy yellow shop?
Like walking into a mango.
Yeah. This is inside a big red mango. But no, we're both from the hospitality world.
Yeah.
So we don't come from a retail background. This is our first retail business.
Mm-hmm.
We come from hospitality. We come from the service industry. And I think that's what really sets us apart in retail, is that we bring a hospitality mindset to it. Mm-hmm. So people come in and we're not just looking at it as like we're trying to make a sale. It's, what are you looking for today? What's going to satisfy you and make you feel good while you're here? Mm-hmm. What makes you feel good when you walk out? What makes you feel good about having been here? Even if you spent a lot of money or not a whole lot of money, but how do you feel about the experience? Because that, I think, is really, that speaks to our bigger mission of creating a community down here.
Okay. And do you guys have any future plans? So are there any new products or initiatives that you are planning to introduce in the near future?
Oh, we have plans for Empire, Mario.
Okay. Watch out.
Seriously, I'll let Zane talk about the wine clubs, because that's something that we're working on now, and we're about to launch in a month or so. So take
Okay. Yeah, we're gonna have a wine subscription offering for our customers. So they can sign up for a wine club. There'll be a few different options as to where the wines come from, whether they're whites, reds, or a mix of the two. And then we'll have pickup parties every quarter, and you get two bottles of wine a month that we hand select, and things that we're really excited about that are exclusive to the club. And so that's one thing that's on the horizon. And, you know, we've been doing tastings here at this lovely blue counter. We clear off all the stuff and we set up glasses on the counter. And we've been doing tastings so far, and we plan to continue to expand that and really lean into the educational side of wine tasting, so that it's not just come sit down, drink some wine and eat some food and we'll see you later, but rather come in and learn a little bit about what it is that you're tasting and why it tastes the way that it does. Because I'm a firm believer that the more you know and understand about something, the more you can appreciate it.
Yeah.
Even if it doesn't lead to you liking it more, because it's possible that you can learn everything there is to learn about something and then still think it tastes like garbage. You know, that's totally possible.
Yeah.
But at least you can appreciate it and understand why it is the way it is. So we're going to lean hard into that and do more educational tastings.
Well, speaking of the educational tastings, it's not just wine. Like
last fall,
we did an olive oil tasting with a producer. They came out with their brand new harvest of olive oils.
Okay.
So we had people who got to taste it before it settled, before it's filtered. Like, what does just raw olive oil taste like?
Oh, okay.
And so things like that, I think, are really eye-opening for a lot of people. And I've gotten a lot of requests for my cooking demos. I used to teach cooking classes.
Yeah.
And so we have some like demo videos on our social media, but I need to get myself together to start doing some more live demos, because we've had a lot of requests for that.
Okay.
So that's immediately on the horizon.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to it. And I'm for sure, you know, people who are watching this, and if you live like, you know, near Pittsburgh, I'm for sure that, or anywhere in the Bay Area, you know, come on through and then stay tuned for like the fresh new updates.
All right, my last business question is basically, okay, advice for entrepreneurs. So what advice will you give other couples or individuals who are thinking about starting their own small business?
Well, I think first of all, and very basic, is just do your homework.
Yeah.
You know what you're getting into. Just don't jump into it on a whim.
Yeah.
So, you know, you should really know the industry that you're trying to break into. So for us, I think the most eye-opening part of it for me was just how many permits we needed, how expensive those permits are, all the crazy requirements for those permits. And yeah, it's
and how long it takes
long
for
it
them
takes.
To be pushed through.
Yes. And so you really have to, because you know, time is money. So you start, you sign a lease on a space, and then you have to start paying rent at a certain point. And in the meantime, you're still waiting for permits. You can't do anything. You can't collect any money. You can't order product. You really are just sitting there twiddling your thumbs waiting for permits. So really timing and planning, I think just don't jump into it on a whim. Take it seriously.
And it's not like this information isn't out there. In fact, what are some of the resources that you used to get the information you needed, like SBDC?
Yeah, the SBDC, they do a really great job. I talked to them first before I was even done with my business plan. I reached out to the SBDC, the Small Business Development Corporation, and they have an East Bay group, and it's all free resources for entrepreneurs, and they were amazingly helpful. They assign you an advisor in the field that you want to be in, and they can just kind of give you a big general overview, and then you plan one-on-one classes, where I had my advisor sit down with my business plan. She looked through my business plan and she was like, how did you come up with these margins? Do you think we can play with these margins? Where are you accounting for your salary? Like, getting into the nitty-gritty.
Yeah.
So that was one resource. I just went down to the city planning office at City Hall. I was totally green. I didn't even know where to start. I was just like, I have this idea.
Yeah.
How do I do this? And I got a stack of papers about this stake, and they referred me to the Chamber of Commerce. To the Contra Costa Environmental Health, like they told me all the permits I would need, and you know, you just start contacting people before you start making any plans.
Okay.
Do as much research as you can, but the resources are out there. But City Hall Planning and the Chamber of Commerce, those are really really good places to start.
Okay, people, take your notes, because they're dropping in a lot of good gems.
I mean, we're still in it, you know? We're still in that startup phase. We're only 4 months old, so it's still fresh in my memory. So if there's any trauma on my face, let me know.
Hey, we're doing wine tasting today. It's a fall Thanksgiving-inspired wine tasting. Chef Danielle has some tasty bites that she's preparing back in the back room there, warming it up for you, a little veggie hash.
As a chef, Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday, so you know we have to do it up. So we're starting with some bubbly. What are you doing on such a beautiful day?
Well, the question is, why aren't you here to taste wine with us? But you got all day. We're starting now. I'm popping open this bottle of sparkling Nebbiolo, which is a wacky wine. But
I love pink bubbles.
Super exciting. Pink bubbles, yeah. Opening this up now. We've got a white wine from Le Marche, which is on the east coast of Italy.
made from a grape called Passerina, which means little bird. We also have some Cerasuolo di Vittoria, which is a Sicilian red blend. And then we've got a local-ish Monterey County Central Coast red wine made from Grenache, Syrah, and Mourvedre.
Can I just compliment you on that professional opening?
Thank you.
It's like you've done this before.
A few times in my career. A little bit of sparkling Nebbiolo Rosé, very light pink,
pretty.
Super light. But we're looking forward to seeing you down here at Dr. Bird Market, 90 East 4th Street, for a little tasting of some wines and some nibbles of some bites.
Don't miss out. I want to drink this all day.
And we're going to.